Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Three Crooked Kings, written by Matthew Condon and read by David Tredinnick. The dedication reads, "For Katie Kate and our children, Finnegan and Bridie Rose." By the time her children peered through the bedroom door and discovered her body, she'd been dead for several hours. Her petite corpse, dressed in a summer nightie, was propped up against some pillows in the narrow bed of the spare room. Her hand was raised in a claw. Her face, partially lit by the morning light through frosted louvers, was fixed in a grimace. The dead woman's small son fled to his father in the back bedroom of the flat in Bonnie Avenue, Clayfield, in Brisbane's inner northeast. The eldest daughter, who had also come to the bedroom doorway, stopped and stared in shock, then ran to the phone and called the ambulance. It was about 8:15 a.m. on Saturday, the 4th of March, 1972. In the bed in that cramped, airless room was the late Shirley Margaret Brifman, 35, former prostitute and brothel madam, and informant and lover to senior corrupt police in Queensland and New South Wales. The year before, she had blown the whistle on the bent coppers she had been paying off for over a decade, agreeing to a live national television interview and effectively signing her own death warrant. In less than 5 weeks, she was due to appear as the chief witness against a senior Queensland detective in a perjury case. She knew it was coming, and that she had to die. She knew too much, and had said too much. Brifman had been given an ultimatum by the former cop she'd once called her close friends. Either commit suicide, or we'll kill your children. Brifman had overdosed many times in the past, but against all odds, she had continued to survive. Only hours before her kids found the body in a state of rigor mortis, Brifman received a visitor to the flat in Bonnie Avenue. She knew someone was coming to deliver her a cocktail of drugs that would finally do the job properly. Brifman and the visitor talked quietly in the foyer of the first floor flat. Then she was handed a small amber jar of lethal drugs. The visitor left around midnight. So Shirley Brifman, crying and shaking with fright, swallowed the contents of the jar, stuffed it under the mattress in the spare room, reclined on a bank of pillows in the dark, and saved her children. Later that chaotic Saturday, when the police and ambulance officers and coroner's officials had left the scene, the shock of her mother's sudden death finally hit Shirley's eldest daughter. Mary Ann Brifman, just 15 years old, issued a scream of grief so loud it disturbed the elderly neighbours in the house out the back. Shirley Margaret Brifman would be buried in an expensive casket in her hometown of Atherton in far north Queensland. There would be no inquest into her death. Her official suicide file would vanish into police headquarters archives. But her death and her name would continue to haunt those men who destroyed her. ''1940s to 1950s. The Probationary. The storm blew in from the west around 6:10 p.m. It had been a humid Sunday, and the wind and rain roared over the tree fringes of Mount Cootha and down into the bowl of the inner Brisbane suburbs of Barden, Rosalie and Paddington, strafing the ridges and gullies and the suburbs' timber and corrugated iron houses. Other dangerous cells were ranging across Greater Brisbane, throwing lightning to earth. Trees were felled. Rectangles of roof iron lifted off and sliced through electrical wires. Flower beds were beaten down. By 6:30 p.m. the storm had passed, and residents of the city's inner west, their evening dinner interrupted, emerged to inspect the damage. It was the 16th of January, 1949. Up on the neighbouring ridge of Petrie Terrace, 110 young police cadets, in training at the police depot, An imposing brown brick edifice and its attendant two-storey wooden sleeping dormitory facing the Brisbane River and the wild pubs and bordellos of South Brisbane had had their tea in the ground floor canteen. For 9 weeks, the recruits, young men from all over the state, had lived shoulder to shoulder. Most had little formal education. Some had worked as post office boys or on the land on the family property or behind the counter in grocery stores before entering the machine of Queensland's post-war constabulary. The Americans had left Brisbane a few years earlier, and the town had settled back into its quasi-rural mediocrity. Pike Brothers Menswear in Queen Street no longer had a need for its specialist military cutter, and orders for imperial winter coats dropped to nothing. In the wake of war, Brisbane was forced to stare once again at its own face, plain and unremarkable. A subtropical tableau that, for a few years in the 1940s, had doubled in population with the arrival of the US military and become something resembling glamorous. The city, all oxblood iron awnings, sandstone banks, and the Salvation Army band playing in King George Square, was inexplicably at the forefront of things that mattered in the world. And it was crawling with US military men in their expensive and beautifully made salmon-hued uniforms. Hollywood no longer belonged on the screens of the Regent and Her Majesty's and the Metro. It was living and breathing on the streets of Brisbane. Then the chic evaporated, and Brisbane went back to being Brisbane. And in the residue of a city once bristling with wartime strength and force and protection, and missing some of its young women, caught in the slipstream of the Americans' departure, came an inevitable vacuum. The Queensland capital needed to firm up its local police force. So on that Sunday night, in the aftermath of the storm, the city cleansed and steaming, the police cadets at the depot returned to their quarters, a long, rectangular dormitory crammed with steel cots and lockers. Some of the men were nervous. From this night on, there would be no more lectures from former school teacher, Senior Constable Merv Callahan. No more marching with old rifles on the parade ground. No more memorising and tests. For those several weeks, they had risen at 6 a.m, made their beds with precision, attended classes on policing and the law, performed physical training exercises, and retired to their cots by 9 p.m. They were not permitted to socialise, despite the Christmas and New Year season. They could not catch a quick tram into town and buy Yuletide gifts for their families, their girlfriends. They had to sit through 52 lectures before their training was done. As the storm headed out into Moreton Bay, the men joked and smoked or contemplated the view of the parade ground through the lattice on the veranda of the dormitory. They had, the day before, been issued their navy police uniforms. 2 pairs of trousers, 2 shirts, 4 detachable collars, a tunic, a tie, a white helmet, and a pair of black boots. Each was also handed a wooden baton and a pair of handcuffs, some so ancient they didn't function. On that weekend, they made sure their collars were starched at the local cleaners. That Sunday night after tea, a young cadet, Terence Terry Murray Lewis, 20, sat on his bed and buffed his new boots. Just a few months earlier, he'd been manning a counter at the Main Roads Commission's Liquid Fuel Control Board office at the corner of Albert and Turbot Streets. And before that, he'd worked as a messenger boy for the US Army, small ships branch, water transport division, across the river at Bulimba during the war. And prior to that, he'd manned another counter at Pike Brothers Menswear, and another at Greer and Jamison Clothiers before that. Lewis had been looking for direction, for some semblance of a career, since he left school at the age of 12, following the separation of his father and mother. By chance, at the Liquid Fuel Control Board, opposite the Roma Street Police Station, he'd found one. He'd got to talking with former detectives and constables who worked with him at the fuel board, and they suggested he join the police. Young Lewis was a little in awe of one of the men, Walter Wally Wright. Walter had been a detective. Another was Stuart, Stewie Willis, a constable based at Nundah Police Station who'd retired early due to injury. "Why don't you go up to the police depot and join?" they suggested. "They're desperate for keen young men," they told him. "If you can breathe in and out, you'll qualify." Lewis was tall, over 180 centimetres, and weighed in at 67 kilograms. He was living in Hawthorne with his mother and stepfather, though he would never think of him, let alone refer to him as his stepfather. Lewis played no sport. He had few, if any, male friends. As a child of the Depression, he was tight with his finances. Recently, though, he'd met a pretty young woman, Hazel Gould, who had come into the fuel board for the motor loss assessor she worked for. He was tired of his living arrangements and of working on the busy counter. He saw no future for himself. But he did quite literally see the Roma Street police station every day when he came to and left work. And suddenly it made sense. The police force. It was structured, and its administrative demands, record-keeping, diaries, logbooks, charge sheets, would complement his fastidious nature. It was regular pay. It would take him away from counters. And there was Hazel, 16, who would soon become his first ever formal girlfriend to consider. So colleagues Wright and Willis took Lewis up past the rail yards to the depot on the Petrie Terrace rise, where he met two sergeants and lecturer Callahan and had his medical. He was a little underweight, but they needed new recruits. Although he was 20, he had the face of a hurt, vulnerable boy. And about him, too, was a vague aura of disappointment. He'd already been out working in the world for 8 years, and it seemed to have prematurely wearied him. He was estranged from his father, who was still living in Ipswich after his wife abandoned him. Lewis's mother, originally from Brisbane and a part of the large Hanlon family, prominent in the city's horse training and racing circles, never took to Ipswich. It was devoid of glamour. It was too far from the charmed racing suburbs of Ascot and Hamilton, and, specifically, the Doomben and Eagle Farm racecourses. Lewis, then 10 years old, came home from school one day to find his mother and only sister, 2 years younger, had simply disappeared. He waited alone until his father came home from work at the Ipswich Railway Workshops. The boy was offered no explanation as to the absence of his mother and sister. It left him feeling bemused, rejected. "I realised it would have been her fault, not his," Lewis reflects on the separation and subsequent divorce. "I can't even remember her ever kissing me, actually. I can't remember it." A year later, he, too, made the decision to leave his father behind and joined his mother in Brisbane, where he was relegated to a cot bed on the side veranda in Hawthorne. Lewis had a confused concept of family until the police took him in. He entered the police depot as a probationary constable on the 8th of November 1948. The staff at the fuel board farewelled him with the gifts of a travelling bag and a wallet. Those weeks of training and cramming and neatly making his bed at the police depot eventually paid off. On the 7th of January 1949, he sat his probationary examination in law and police duties. Define offence. Define assault. Define arrest. Lewis secured 57.5 marks out of 80. He came third in his class. On the night of the storm, at lights out, Lewis knew that when he woke the following day, he would be stepping into a new life. On a Monday morning in mid-January, he and his fellow recruits would be formally sworn in as officers of the Queensland Police Force and issued their official officer numbers, fitted on their epaulets. His ambitions at that moment may have extended no further than to one day work in plain clothes, like former Detective Walter Wright.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.